what I wanted to do was sort of two things, as announced pretty much by Dick and Hertog in particular. I want to go over the history of Center, and I'll do it in two chapters, if you like. The first chapter is the part that I have experienced firsthand, sort of what I have seen myself. And then the second part is as an outsider after I left the university and sort of what I have seen and what I think has happened. I'm going to start with being pretty critical about, you know, what the university was like when I arrived here. And I cannot repeat often enough, and I hope this also comes across in the film, that there always have been really good people here, and there always have been very smart people, and people had were very creative. But I think there were reasons why at some point there was a real crisis in the university, because I think on balance, on average, the university just wasn't very good. And I'm sort of going to drive home that point and go from there. Okay. So the thing that struck me when I arrived, so I got appointed to the end of 81, I guess I actually arrived early in 82. There are a couple of things that always struck me. One is that they always talked about stars. The Dutch word was koryfeeën. And, you know, it was a really big faculty. And there were you know, koryfeeën. There were really good people. But there were just many, many people who didn't really, to tell you the truth, quite earn their bread the way they should have, I think. And there was this insular capacity. There was this notion to look inward, not to look outward, to sort of, you know, think that the discussion within Tilburg was heard around the world, and it really wasn't. You know, I really think the outside world didn't really agree with, you know, the notion that what was going on here was all that important, partly because we didn't communicate very well. We didn't really, you know, whatever we did, we didn't always sort of bother to explain to the rest of the world what we were doing. And part of that is not publishing in English. You know, for better or worse, if you want to be heard, you have to publish in English. That happens to be the lingua franca of economics. And so, you know, Tilburg, I think, you know, some people felt that Tilburg was actually doing pretty well. And of course, if you don't look outside too much, you know, you can sort of keep that belief. But it's pretty clear it wasn't true. And there's sort of two ways. And actually, I'll talk about this top 40 ad nauseum. I sort of apologize for that, but I like numbers. And these are sort of readily accessible numbers. So I'll talk about these numbers a couple of times. And I know, you know, numbers aren't everything, but sometimes they illustrate a point. The other thing that happened, though, was that at some point, the Ministry of Education started external evaluations of disciplines and across universities. And when economics was evaluated, it turned out that by the criteria used by the ministry, Tilburg was at the bottom of the heap. And of course, there was a lot of internal discussion, and people would say, well, you know, all these rankings are nonsense, it's all wrong, we're actually much better than everyone thinks. But I think many, many people would agree, well, maybe they had a point. Maybe there was a reason to believe that, you know, things weren't as great as people would think. And I, of course, the other side is always, as an economist, you think of production. So you think of input and output. So what you see outside is publications, teaching, quality of students. On the inside, you look sort of at how things are organized. And these were a number of things that really struck me sort of being here. For one thing, it was very much a 9-to-5 place. And Dutch universities generally had a tendency to be 9-to-5, but, you know, Tilburg was pretty extreme. And I've been told by the then director of the Faculty of Economics that, you know, I had no business coming in on the weekend because, you know, on Sunday you went to church and on Saturday you went shopping with your wife. And that was basically the idea. And when the university got a new computer that no longer required operators to keep it alive during the weekend, the initial instinct was to actually shut it off Friday night anyway, because, you know, also computer, I guess, needs to go to church or whatever. So it actually took some action to sort of convince that maybe it wasn't a bad idea to have the computer work over the weekend. And you know, for those of you who are not sort of in academia every day, there are certain characteristics of universities that sort of tell you whether something is lively or not. And maybe the best indicator of all is the seminar culture. Are there many seminars? Are there many visitors coming through? Are there many things going on? The Faculty of Economics had a faculty-wide seminar committee, and they organized one seminar a month. And I remember at least one occasion where the outside speaker came from Nijmegen, no one showed up, and he then swore that he would never return to Tilburg again. And bureaucracy, you know, sort of needless to say, bureaucracy was really important. I'm not going to sort of bore you too much with it. You know, everyone knows horror stories about bureaucracy, so I don't need to repeat them. So things have changed since then. And I want to talk a little bit about why they changed, how they changed, and in what sort of environment. And as Case Kudak already said, you know, clearly the external threats were a wake-up call in a number of stages. I think sort of half a year after I arrived to become a professor of econometrics, Roland Felt in his wisdom decided that econometrics in Tilburg had to be scrapped. You know, and that sort of gets your attention, okay? And then later on, a couple of years later, he decided that, or the minister decided, I guess it was, decided, well, maybe psychology we didn't really need, and I guess languages was another one. So, you know, the university was under threat, and it was actually not just a couple of departments, because I remember at least one rector of a university who said, well, you know, we can sort of get rid of all these budgetary problems by closing down just the whole university. And it was pretty clear which one he was thinking of, you know. So the university was not in a sort of a pleasant spot at that point. So, so I've already mentioned his name, so, you know, this is Roel. You can see what hotel he's in. I'm sure he'll tell you where it is. And I think maybe the film will sort of go into this a little more, but I didn't actually know Roel was going to be here, but I'm going to say what I wanted to say anyway. If there is one person who has changed universities in this country, it's Roel, and in two ways, carrots and sticks, by threatening, and I think it's really important at some point to say, you know, lack of quality must have consequences, but then also provide the environment in which there is room for improvement. And so the true founder of Center is Roel. I mean, it was Roel's idea to say, you know, one way to improve things is to have a place where we concentrate quality. And one of the conditions, I'm not going to talk about it because I sort of forgot, I guess, one of the conditions was we would only get funded if we would bring in a number of really good Dutch economists abroad. And it was, you know, it was a pretty hard work to get people to come to Tilburg at that time, given sort of where we were. But it was the right way to think about it. You know, if you want to be ambitious, you have to show that you're able to bring in good people. And, you know, we have worked hard, and I think it has turned out to be an extremely successful model. So, you know, once again, I apologize, probably three more times before I'm done about this emphasis of the top 40. So there was this, it was not just the ministry. The early 80s were a period of change. The 70s were complacent. I guess there was the natural gas. Everyone was on unemployment benefits. You know, money was no problem. And sort of the early 80s, it became clear that things had to change. And the culture changed in many, many different ways. And also within universities, and increasingly there were people who realized that, you know, it couldn't go on like this. Something had to change. And you had to be more outward looking, and there had to be more attention for what people actually doing. So there was this one sort of little gimmick, little joke that started by an anonymous writer who started publishing top 40s of economists. And the innovation was that this concentrated on publications in international journals, right? And of course, there was a reason, because it was meant to be a counterbalance to the public discussion within the country. You know, it doesn't mean that the public discussion is not important, but at the end of the day, you also have to be willing to sort of expose yourself to the quality judgment of people in other countries. And so it so happens that recently I got an email from Tom Nederhoff from Leiden University, who wrote an article in Scientometrics, in which he talks about it, and he sort of argues that it actually had some effect. And he sort of, I have some quotes, some are serious and others I think are sort of maybe not really worth thinking about too much. So this sort of is his analysis. So, you know, so there have been more rankings in various places, but this one was sort of remarkably long-lived. It sort of, you know, it's changed a little bit, but I think part of the reason why it was long-lived is there was sort of deep down an agreement in the profession that something like this was needed. You know, it didn't have to be take this form, but something was needed that sort of made clear that, you know, publications, output, these things matter. After all, we get paid by the taxpayer, and that's, you know, that's why we should somehow